Revelation chapter 4, beginning with verse 2, says this. Behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne, and he that sat was to look upon like jasper and a sardius stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 thrones, and upon the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderclaps and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf. And the third beast had a face as a man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him. And they were full of eyes within. And they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I ask your God today that you would help us to recognize just how important it is that we understand the power, God, of your presence. That we understand the influence of your presence. And that we, dear God, would allow ourselves to live in your presence. God, help us to know how to live a life where we encounter you consistently. And help us today to be ready for the encounter that we all will face. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. What I want to speak to you this morning on the topic of is the title, The Encounter. And in verse number 8, I want to set the stage, Revelation chapter 4, verse 8, I want to set the stage for what really is critical to understand when we talk about the encounter. And that verse says, those 4 beasts that I read about just a moment ago, rest not day and night. Now notice, if you read through Revelation, there is a moment in time where there is silence in heaven. That is a critical moment in history. Because ever in the past and ever going forward, these 4 beasts have the responsibility to cry out unto Almighty God consistently, never stopping until that moment, crying out these words, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come, ever eternal, without beginning and without end, a God, the God of the universe, who has none likened unto him. He is absolutely the one true living God. The creator of the universe is that one true holy God. And there is something that separates mankind from that holy God, and that is sin. God created us in his image, and yet we turned our backs on him to be as gods. And that rebellion, that act of rebellion against the one thing God told us not to do, that act of rebellion what separates all of mankind's sins from a holy God. But that same holy God is a loving God, and His desire is that you and I spend eternity with Him. He created us to spend eternity with Him. He created us to be in relationship with Him. So the question I have is, what must we do to be ready for and know that we must be ready for the encounter? The encounter. The first thing that we have to understand, and this is why I said that scripture in Revelation chapter 4 verse 8 is so critical. We must understand that He is a holy God. A holy God. We do not preach this, we do not teach this a lot in today's church. But it is a fact that must be dealt with, or we can never really have that relationship we need with Him. We must understand who He is and what He is. And He is God Almighty. And yes, God loves us. And yes, He wants to dwell with us. And yes, He wants a relationship with us. But so many times, and especially in our day and time today, we have come to the point where we do not respect any authority whatsoever, and especially the one ultimate true authority, which is Almighty God. You see, in order to respect God for who He is, we have to understand that He is holy. What does that mean? It means that He is unblemished. That there is no fault in Him. That there is nothing in Him that is tinged in the slightest bit. He is absolutely pure, white, holy. No sin within Him anywhere. Revelation chapter 4 that I just read to you, it describes this holy God seated on His throne. And there are 24 elders around Him. And those beasts cry, "Holy, holy, holy," continuously, repetitively, without ceasing. We see that there are encounters, there are others through the Bible that we read about that have had relationship with God, but when they came into contact with the Holy God, it had a strong impact on them. In Acts chapter 7, Stephen is speaking the gospel. And if you read Acts chapter 6, because you really can't understand Acts chapter 7 until you read Acts chapter 6. In Acts chapter 6, Stephen is ministering the gospel and he's brought before the leaders of the synagogue, and they are questioning him, "What are you doing? You are speaking the name of someone, and you're trying to say that He is greater than Moses. You're trying to say He's greater than Abraham. You're trying to speak and talk about Him and say things." And they bring in false witnesses that say that he's preaching that this Jesus is going to tear down the temple and destroy it, and he's going to go another direction in his life. That Jesus is going to change direction of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the truth is, this gospel is not changing. It's just continuing. Jesus Himself said, "I did not come to eliminate the Old Testament. I did not come to eliminate the law of Moses. I came to fulfill it, and I came to bring you something that is too true and dynamic and new and amazing, that is going to fulfill it and is going to transform your life. It is going to take you from that depth of sin I talked about, and it is going to give you the ability to have an encounter with the Almighty that you could not have had prior to Jesus Christ. And Stephen is speaking to them. And he says, Moses, walking in the desert after 40 years of being separated from Egypt, he's out there tending the flocks of his father-in-law, and it's nighttime. All of a sudden, there's a fire. Some people say it's nighttime. We don't know what time of day it was. It doesn't even tell us that. But even a bush burning in the middle of the desert in the day that's not being consumed is a pretty amazing thing. And Moses is tending to the sheep and he sees this bush burning, not being consumed, and he is drawn to it. The Bible says the angel of the Lord basically calls out to him and draws him. There's a presence there that he doesn't understand. And he comes near, and all of a sudden, he hears the voice of Almighty God say, Moses, take off your shoes, for the ground you stand on is holy ground. You're having an encounter with the holy. And Moses hides himself. Moses shades himself because he doesn't want to look upon a holy, amazing, awesome God. You see, what we have in today's society is a very sincere problem. No one wants to listen to authority. No one wants to respect authority, least of all God. When we come into the presence of the Holy, there needs to be an awe about us. No, don't get me wrong. I'm going to get here in a minute. We can have a personal relationship with the Holy. And that's true, but I want to get to that. But first, I want us to understand that this relationship with the Holy has to be one of awe and respect. We need the church today to preach about a holy God, a God who is the creator of the universe, who has no sin in Him, no spot in Him, no blemish in Him. He is the holy God of heaven, and we need to learn to respect Him. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah, it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne high and exalted. And His train filled the temple. How can we read these words and imagine and understand that He's still on the throne and His train still fills the temple? He's still there. He has not been diminished. And Isaiah comes in contact with Him, and he is drawn into the temple. He said, there were seraphims. We won't go into that because I'm not here to preach about seraphim. But those seraphim are doing exactly what the beasts in Revelation are doing. And in fact, the description is the same, and they had six wings each. So are these the same beings flying around the throne and crying the same words? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole world, the whole earth is full of His glory. And notice this. It says the post of the door moved at the voice of Him that cried. And the house was filled with smoke. Let me tell you. Ever since I was young, I've known that you can sense the presence of God. We sang about that this morning. The one verse said, when I walked into this place, I sensed His presence. And I knew that He was here in this place. For we are standing on holy ground. And Isaiah recognized, I'm in holy ground. The Bible says he fell to his face. And he said, woe is me, for I am undone. In other words, I'm sinful. I'm a man of unclean lips. And I dwell among a people of unclean lips. I'll tell you something the church needs today. It is a revelation of the divine God that will bring us to our knees and recognize that we are an unclean people and we dwell among an unclean people. But there is a God in heaven who has the ability to change that. So we do have an encounter with the Holy. See, we are sinful. We're sinful. We serve a holy God, and we are bound in sin. You say, wait a minute, Pastor. Oh, now, I know some of y'all, you've got Jesus in your heart. I'm getting to you. But we are all sinful men. Some of us, hallelujah, have been redeemed. We're going to get to that. But we have to recognize, in this day, in this time, when the world is trying to tell us to follow their directives, their motivations, their new way of living, they're trying to get us to follow the Baals of this time, the Molochs of this time. They're trying to get us to follow the fertility goddesses of this time. They're trying to get us to do that. You say, oh, but they're not out there saying those names, Pastor. They might as well be, because what the society we live in today is trying to do is to get us to bow at the altar of the false gods of this time.
Yes. Yes.
In Romans chapter 5, we're told about this. By one man sin entered the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Romans chapter 3 verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We have to recognize, you see, in this day and time, my friend, the church needs to help the world know that it is a sinful place. And the sin is rampant. And you can call it what you want to. You can call it alternate lifestyle. You can call it whatever you will. You can name it by all other names, but it is sin. And the world must recognize that sin is what is separating us from a communion with the Almighty God of heaven, who desires nothing more than to have a relationship with you. Oh, we live in a day where everybody's looking here and there. They're looking all over this planet, trying to find something that will fill that hole in their soul that only God can fill. Romans chapter 5 says, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. I said that. Even so, we have a Savior. Verse 18 says, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men, justification unto life. Even as by one man sin entered into the world, by one man, one Redeemer, one Savior, who was more than man, who was God. But can I dare say, I don't want to phrase it this way, but I feel like it, more than God. I mean, how can you be more than God? You can't. But He stepped down off of that throne. The Son of God. The Most Holy. And He stepped down into this planet. And by the power of the Holy Ghost was embedded and infused somehow into a little baby. Born and raised a man, but all God. How? I don't know. I don't know. I wish I had some of these answers. I'm telling you, I've been pastoring, I've been ministering the gospel of Christ for more than 41 years. I don't know how it's done, but I know it's done because I've been redeemed by love divine. Glory, glory, Christ is mine. So by the righteousness of one, the free gift of life has been given to us. Why? John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved this world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into this world to condemn it, but that the world through Him might be saved. And there is no name given among men whereby we can be saved except that one mighty, holy name, Yeshua, Jesus, Messiah.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
The Savior. Everybody's looking for a Savior. Can I just tell you, there isn't a politician out there that can save us. Watch out, Pastor. Don't meddle. I'm not trying. But let me tell you something. They don't exist. He's already come. The Savior has already come. Hallelujah. We don't need to look for another. What America needs, what the world needs, is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, born into fleshly man. Died on the cross of Calvary, buried in a tomb until the third day when He rose triumphantly, and today He has ascended to the throne of God. So how can you be ready? How can you be ready? It's very important that we be ready. I believe it's not too much longer before Jesus comes and takes His bride. I believe that with all my heart. I wake up every morning going, how did that happen? I walk through the day. I went out to my kitchen this morning, early hours. I rolled open the blind to the back door. And I looked out at the sunrise. In the east. And all of a sudden, a sense came over me and said, perhaps today, I'm looking at the eastern sky. Perhaps today, as the lightning shineth from the east unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Oh, it says that there is going to be a moment in a twinkling of an eye at the last trump. The trump shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall be raised. We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. I thought, what about today? It was so strange. I'm walking around my kitchen. I'm making my coffee. The Lord placed it on my heart. What if this is the last pot of coffee I ever make on this earth? You say, Pastor, that's silly. No. No, my friend. My Bible tells me that when you see some of these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. But we got to be ready. We have to have a relationship with the Holy. Now, how can you have a relationship with the Holy? I am undone. I am sinful. I am sinful man. Moses encounters the burning bush and shields himself. Isaiah encounters the Holy God with his train filling the temple and falls down and confesses he is a man of unclean lips. We just can't do it. I'll tell you how we do it. Bible says, chapter 9, I believe it's Matthew, Jesus entered into a ship, and he passed over and he came into his own city, and they brought him a man sick of a palsy. Notice this word. They brought him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed, and Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the man sick of the palsy, did he say, rise, be healed? No, he did not. And it shocked everybody around him. He did not say, rise and be healed. He didn't say, I'm giving you the healing power, the balm of God. He said, son, be of good cheer. Thy sins be forgiven. I'll tell you what. That is the greatest proclamation that you can get. A few years back, my mom was diagnosed with terminal cancer. We prayed hard. She got better. We were all excited. Look what God has done. And we are excited. But then cancer reared its ugly head in her life. We prayed and we prayed hard. And a little over 4 years ago, she passed away. What kind of faith do you have, Pastor? The kind that knows that my mom knew Jesus Christ yeah. as her personal Savior.
Yeah.
And she's in heaven.
Yeah.
That's the kind of faith I have.
Yeah.
It is the greatest proclamation when Jesus says, be of good cheer. Thy sins are forgiven thee. If the sick of the palsy had never risen off that bed, that would be the greatest proclamation that ever could come into his life. But notice what Jesus did. Because they all were like, oh my goodness, he just told him sins are forgiven. Oh my goodness, okay. Oh, what is wrong with this guy? You can't do that. Well, you can if you're the Son of God. You know, I'm just going to throw this in here real quick and then I'm moving on. But do you know that the Bible says those whose sins you forgive, those sins are forgiven them. But those whose sins you remit, those whose sins you hold on to, this is a very big responsibility we have. There are people who, in our human minds, don't deserve forgiveness. And you know what? Some of them don't. None of us deserve forgiveness. But sometimes we are so deeply hurt. And I know what that's like. I've had people in the church hurt me so bad. Janet can tell you, my wife, I've gone home and I've sobbed because of some of the things people have said and done against me as a pastor, as a child of God. I have literally cried myself to sleep some nights because of the hurt. And only one person knows that besides God, and that's my wife. She has watched me. But you know what? There came a day when one of those people who hurt me so desperately needed ministry. And I walked into that house. And God overwhelmed my heart. And said, you get over and hug them. You pray with them. And I tell you what, the rest of the house, Janet was there. The others were there. They looked at me. They were shocked. But something came over my heart, and suddenly it didn't matter what had been done to me. There was ministry to be done. I grabbed that person and I hugged them and I held them tight. And I prayed with them and I wept with them. And do you know from that moment on, I still remember the things, but it doesn't hurt anymore. You know why? Because there is a forgiveness. Jesus Christ is the great Redeemer. He is the forgiver of all sin. And He looks into our lives and says, I don't care what you've done. I died for that sin. I died for you. I died that you might be redeemed. Thy sins be forgiven thee. And then the Bible says, Jesus said, is it easier to say your sins are forgiven you or to rise and walk? But so that you know the Son of Man has the ability to forgive sin. And He turned over to the sick of the palsy, grabbed him by the hand and said, rise, take up your bed and walk. And from that moment, he was transformed. He was healed. Oh, my friend. The Bible says he arose and departed to his house. You know that you can have a relationship with the Holy because there is a Holy God who loves you, cares for you. There is a Holy God who wants nothing greater, better than to develop His relationship with you. That's how you approach a holy God. It's through Jesus Christ. He's the only name. Because you need to be ready for the encounter. You need to be ready for the encounter. How are you going to encounter the holy? Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah in the throne room of God falls to his face, cannot even imagine standing there in his holy presence. I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips. And the Bible says that in the midst of these beings crying out, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, in the midst of this moment, God dispatches an angel to take tongs and grab a coal off of the altar of God. A flaming coal. And the Bible says the angel goes and touches it to Isaiah's lips. And suddenly, Isaiah says something changed. Suddenly I can stand in the holy. I can sit in the presence of the holy. I can be in the presence of the Holy One. Why? Because the sacrifice, the altar, the flame from the fires of the altar of God were the sacrifices. You see, this is Old Testament. In the New Testament, that sacrifice is Jesus. And the Bible says, lo, this has touched thy lips, thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. That's what has to take place in the encounter. in Moses' situation, in Exodus chapter 33. Moses has already had the fiery bush, the burning bush experience. Now, he's about to lead the children of Israel out into the wilderness on what is going to turn out to be a 40-year journey. He doesn't know that. He is in the mountain of God. And he is communing with God. And he's communing with the Holy. And he says, God, please reveal yourself to me. And God says, you can't see the Holy. You can't see my face. But here's what I'm going to do. Now, I want you to understand this, because a lot of people look right over this story and they run on into the wilderness. But you need to have a momentary encounter with God in the mountain of Sinai. You need a touch from God that is different, that is iconic, that is life-changing. And Moses said, please reveal yourself to me. And God says, you can't see my face, but here's what I'm going to do. You come back tomorrow. I'm going to prepare a place for you. Does that sound familiar to anybody? I'm going to prepare a place for you. Oh, my friend, let me tell you, when God prepares a place for you, you're going to be okay. Moses goes back to God. And in Exodus chapter 33, God says, there's a cleft in the rock. There's a place I've prepared. You can't see me face to face yet, but I've prepared a place of refuge where I can reveal myself. Let me tell you something, friend. We live in a sinful world. We are sinful men. The blood of Jesus Christ has forgiven us of our sin. And right now, while we live in this sinful world, there's a place in the rock. There's a cleft in the rock that Jesus has paid for. And you go there, and God can reveal Himself to you there. You can have an encounter with the Holy. Oh, it's time for the church to have an encounter. It's time for God's people to have an encounter. It's time for us to find that place in the cleft of the rock.
Amen.
Now notice this. I gotta move on. The Lord descended in the cleft, stood with him there. And the Lord passed by before him. And Moses got a revelation from Genesis to Revelation of the almighty, loving, amazing, merciful God of the universe. The Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions. Oh, you see, God takes on a whole new light. There's a whole new meaning to the holy, my friend, when you are in the cleft of the rock and God reveals himself. Now he is still holy. He is still righteous. He is still the almighty, unwavering God of the universe. But now, he is revealing himself to you as the forgiving, long-suffering, merciful God of the universe that will forgive you of your sins and heal you. You see, when the temple in Solomon's day was dedicated, Solomon's prayer, a lot of people miss this part. Solomon prayed at the dedication of the temple, God, attend your ear to what prayers are given at this place. And if we sin, forgive us. If we turn from you and we return to you, forgive us. That was Solomon's prayer. And then God follows that up by giving Solomon, waking him in the middle of the night, and says, Solomon, I have heard your prayer. I have given ear to what you asked. And so, because of your prayer, you see, it's time for the church to pray for the lost. It's time for the church to pray for our nation. It's time for the church to pray for this world. The church has neglected its duties. It's become a place of entertainment. But it's time to get back in the pulpits and get back in the altars and get to a place where we proclaim the holy God of the universe. Pray. And really pray. Not just now I lay me down to sleep. Oh Lord, my soul, please keep. If I should die before I wake, pray thee, Lord, my soul to take. God bless. We prayed that when we were kids. I believe it was Paul that said, when I was a child, I spake like a child. But I'm a grown man now. You know, my son, Joshua, helping me back there running our sound system today. When he was a baby, we had to feed him. We had to nurture him, taught him to walk. Sometimes I'd hold his hand while we walked so that he didn't fall and stumble. He got older. I started coaching him in football. Taught him how to do some of those plays. He had a natural talent. Boy's amazing. As coach, I would call in the plays. He would perform them. You know, God's like that with us. When we're new Christians, when we're babies, okay, I'll nurture you. I'll get you up there. But you know what? Some of y'all are grown up now. I don't expect to have to feed Joshua, put the little spoon out there and make it an airplane to get him to eat. You know why? Because he's grown up now. It is time for the church to be grown up. It is time to stop sucking on milk and start eating the meat of the Word of God and to recognize that it's time for the church to stop being an entertainment center and to be a salvation center where the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached about a holy God and a loving Savior. Hebrews chapter 4. I really am drawing this to a close. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Let's hold tightly to what Jesus said. What did Jesus say? The things that I do, you shall do, and even greater. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Now, there's nothing wrong with good singing. There's nothing wrong with good worship. There's nothing wrong with a great band when you're doing it for the Lord. But God didn't say, Jesus didn't say, if you love me, get the best band in the world and make sure that we sing good songs that get people upbeat. No. No. He said, if you love me, keep my Word, keep my commandments, follow after me. And it's time for the church to do that. He said, go into all the world and teach all nations to learn great music. No. Go into all the world and teach all nations to observe whatever I have commanded you. It is time. It's great to have great music. It's great to have a good preacher. If you think you do, and if you don't, I'm really sorry. But, you know, the key to this whole thing is we're not here to entertain. We are here to lift up the name of Jesus, the name above all names. It is through Him and only through Him, the gate, the way. I am the way, Jesus said, the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Anybody who tries to get in any other way is a thief and a robber. It's time for the world to know that Jesus Jesus Christ is the Savior of the Muslim. He is the Savior of the anarchist. He is the Savior of the atheist. He is the Savior of the Buddhist. He is the Savior of the world. Wow, I only got part way through my scripture. For we have not an high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we, yet without sin. Let us therefore, and this is where I want to bring it to a close, bringing it in for a landing. Therefore come boldly. Boldly. Oh, no longer are we there needing to pull off the altar. No longer do we have to shield our face. No longer do we have to hide in a cleft, except that cleft being Jesus Christ. No longer. But now through the blood of Jesus Christ, who has redeemed us from our sin, who has forgiven us, now we come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Oh, we need the church to wake up, to return. We need a fresh encounter. A fresh encounter. I was listening this morning as I was getting ready, finalizing some things, and I was listening to some of these old worship songs. Worship courses. And Bill Gaither got up and said on that video and said, I wrote this song back in 1963, and I was like, I was 1 year old. But that song has stirred me all these years, and we're about to sing it, by the way. Because I want to close with that song. And then I want us to have a time of prayer. I know we've got a few minutes. There are thousands of churches all across America who have been stirred today to join in prayer, and we want to be part of that. We want to be one of those, however long it takes. Father, as we take up this next hour moment of praise, God, I pray that we would touch your throne. God, give us an encounter today with the holy, I pray. May we lift up your name. Touch every life here, I pray in Jesus. And we're going to take a moment. We're going to have an opportunity here. We're just going to take these knees before the Lord in prayer. And you want to just, right where you are, make an altar at your seat. Do whatever you need to do, however you like to pray. Let's take this next few moments. Let's touch the throne of heaven.